What's up, everybody? We got a skeleton crew here today. Shout out to Joe and Chris. They're both on assignment. Shout out to Joe. He passed his test that he's been talking about to do pharmacology in D.C. at a managerial...
A drug test?
Oh. Of sorts. I've passed those before. and Chris, just who knows? I'm hoping next week, but we shall see. And I don't know, I'll be honest, I don't know if the Joe thing is going to mean that he goes to 9 to 5, in which case we're going to have to figure out a whole extra something else. But that might create more evening shows, which might create larger casts more often. And then I might even go to a whole different format with cameras and everything else. And, you know, but we'll see. We'll see. I do want to say I have Evan here today, the king of Pasaconda.
Hello.
And I have Chucky Ho. Chucky Ho barely made it.
Yes.
We're going to get into that in just a second. But before we do, I had a question. This is a hypothetical question. So go out on the limb that your wife is on board. Okay. Don't play. It could never happen because my wife would never. It's a hypothetical question. Okay. You are going to have, you have a threesome. And you, your wife, and another lady, not the devil's threesome.
Thank you.
And
that's right.
And you wear protection. Mm-hmm. Everybody has a great time. Everybody's on good terms. Then, and after the event, you all go your separate ways. Well, you and your wife stay, but she goes her separate way. And you guys even reminisce. The day is hotter because you're reminiscing about it. Like, you guys are having a blast, right? It's fantastic. And then a month goes by, and you get a call that she's pregnant. And says she's only been with you. And we're going to go out on a limb and assume that it is yours.
Mm-hmm.
Would your wife want an abortion?
No.
Absolutely.
All right, so tell me why, Chucky O, and then
my wife is like, she loves children, and
Evan's wife hates them.
With a passion.
No, like her line of work is with like sick and dying children, and
there might be one more.
I don't even. Oh boy, venturing into the other what ifs. Especially like she would just be like, "Well, can we foster it? Can we adopt it?
Yeah.
Is she willing to
co-parent?"
She would jump into that.
Co-parents.
She would jump into that and go down every train of that before the even flicker of get rid of it comes into play. And we're a little overshare. We're kind of in that realm these days of considering
other options,
surrogate, possibly. Okay. So for her, it's not.
Wouldn't be an option. That makes sense.
Wouldn't bother her at all, I don't think.
That makes sense.
The math adds up for that. I can appreciate that answer. Not the same answer on my end.
Fair enough.
And for maybe different reasons. Uh-huh. First being, we're not having a kid by another woman. That's not going to happen. Mm-hmm. Secondly, we have our own, and we're not looking. There's a reason I got a vasectomy, is because we don't want any more.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I get it's a miracle baby at this point, but
dude, this is God's plan.
Right. I agree. The reason we got it, because we don't want any more. Our twins just turned 11 last week, and we're not starting over.
Right.
And it's more about planning for the future and getting our own plans and being, would we be the best parents available for this this new threesome baby?
Yeah.
You know?
And, would you trade Zach for the new baby?
It depends. I gotta see it.
How's Zach doing these days?
He's good. He's good. That's my man. He's really good. it's starting middle school, and it's like I'm trying to get some stuff together with him.
Yeah.
I think that'd be one of those things like he said a month passed. Yeah, so it was early.
Yeah.
Not like she's got a bump. Like, get her down the steps.
What do you know?
Right. get the coat hanger.
Triple tap.
I think it's it. Now, if the woman wanted to keep it, it's a tough thing to say, but I'd be like, okay, well, we don't want to be involved. Like, that's not our child. So what do we have to sign? Because what happens is you open up yourself for other stuff, because my wife and I, let's say we both say, no, this isn't what we want. And the woman's like, well, my body, my choice, which is great.
Right,
that's fine.
Of course.
I agree. But we just say we don't want to be involved. Well, here comes the obviously the court mandated paternity test and yep. the lawsuit, child support, all this stuff. Now you're trying to take money from us after we told you we didn't want it. So you'd have to kind of sign away your parental rights.
Yeah,
obviously, you know, but it goes down a whole wormhole.
Yeah,
but I feel like in that situation, nah, unless no, ain't no unless. It's not. It's
so
not.
I thought of this question on my way to work. And when I got to work, I asked all the guys immediately. And most of them were more of the Chucky O answer than the Evan answer.
They weren't being honest.
So I called Laura on speakerphone right there to ask her, like what would you do? And I was like, would you want an abortion? And she said no, but I would have a very hard life.
You.
That's Ooh. What she said.
Uh-huh. It ain't worth it.
She said, I would have a very hard life, but I wouldn't want to abort the child, which I just thought was interesting. Because I was my guess for her, but I wasn't 100% sure. I wasn't 100% sure. Chucky O, you had a hard time getting here today.
Oh. Hard time.
Yeah. My man was on Dub P time.
Tell yeah. Yep. Dub P time might be the title. So tell the people what happened.
So, brother, I was riding the Road King here down 144 when the clutch gave out. Oh, yeah, brother.
So no, how fast were you going when it gave out?
I mean, so 55, but... what a clutch on a motorcycle feels like when it gives out a 55 is you turn the throttle and it goes and you don't go any faster. And you're like, well, crap.
Yeah.
So I had to limp it here. It'll limp in the 30 miles per hour, but now it feels like a scooter. Feels like a Vespa. And it's an 800-pound Harley, which shouldn't ever feel like a Vespa.
Yeah, yeah.
So, but it, you know, it's an inevitability. Clutch is a wear item, and I got this motorcycle specifically to do a style of riding. They call them police rodeos. yep, where we ride police. No, it's a police motorcycle rodeos. It's cone course. Some people have seen videos on the TikTok. Mm-hmm.
Just as many pigs as a real rodeo.
Real. Facts. Wow. So it's hard on clutches. You're slipping the clutch a lot in the friction zone to do tight turns and the style of riding. So it again, it's just one of those things of like, I know I'll have to replace the clutch, but I was not hoping to do it today or tomorrow or next
raise
week.
My hand.
Yes, sir. You so sir weird. Over there.
I caught myself. So with that being a common thing that happens, common thing that happens with the bikes, how easy is it to replace and like, is this something that you could probably do yourself or?
So I've got a class coming up next month. If I didn't have that, I could probably do it. It would be messy. But if I take it to a dealership, they're going to pop the primary cover. They can pull the clutch right out. You know, unlike a car that you have to pull the engine out, pull the transmission, put a new clutch in, you can pop off a side cover and probably do a half hour's worth of work. Yeah, that's the upside to this is the
pretty
clutch basket.
Fix,
a pretty simple fix for definitely a Harley dealership or a motorcycle mechanic. So that's
okay.
The upside. It's not like my clutch went out of my car. I'm looking at dropping, you know, thousands of dollars to get
that's
it.
All I was, that's nice. What I was comparing it to, I guess, mentally. So that's why I asked that.
I'm hoping this is like somewhere around a grand to get replaced.
You starting to GoFundMe or are you good?
No, I'm okay.
Man, money bags.
Yeah, like I'm okay.
Hey, give me two of those clutches.
yeah. Upgrade.
Pack a spare in.
Right. Yeah. So it just sucks because I paid, you know, money for a oil change on these bikes is complicated. There's like engine oil, primary oil, and transmission oil. And, you know, that primary oil is relatively new, a few hundred miles on it.
How are you doing on your cone courses?
Great. Have you seen any of the
I have caught some footage on Facebook.
And that's one of the reasons why my wife allowed me to get this motorcycle was she wanted to spend more time with me instead of me like going off and riding off into the sunset.
And we suggested that you just get a sidecar and put her in the sidecar with goggles and a scarf.
She would not have a leather cap. Objection to it. I just wouldn't be able to do this riding anymore. Tight turns. But yeah, she comes and helps me set up these courses and encourages me and keeps me hydrated and keeps sunscreen on me and, you know, coddles my ego when I'm, you know, frustrated. And so she's like my biggest cheerleader on this. And I think her ulterior motive is, I know where you're at. I know you're safe in a parking lot. And if you fall down, we dust you off and you're okay. So, and I'm okay with that because it allowed me to buy a more expensive, nicer motorcycle. And we're going to hopefully maybe next season travel. We're going to Pennsylvania. Maybe
are you
going to
do one of those Jacobs Rossen motorcycle trips?
Well, so Matt, short answer is no.
Okay.
Because Matt Jacobs is well leveled up in his riding. That like he is going to Spain in October, and knows
they are about it.
He knows a guy who runs this Red Bull race. So like not like some I don't know what the equivalent of the Spanish Joe Bob Briggs is, but he's like, oh yes, we will set you up. You will get to ride on the course.
It's Jose Roberto, just
yes, Jose Roberto. But like no, they're getting to travel along, ride parts of this course, go to this other spot, like, you know, total 5-star celebrity treatment.
It's crazy.
In a different country.
Yeah.
So I'm not there.
Yeah, they go out and sleep on a dirt and
get back. They're doing a lot of like
nuts.
In the States, they're doing like rides all up and down the Pacific Northwest, Nevada, California, Utah.
And it's such a ragtag group.
Yes.
Like it's like I wouldn't have put any I wouldn't have assembled these Avengers.
Are they all from the same crew?
different mopping houses.
Okay. Yeah.
Really?
But
and they just kind of put it out there and say, hey, who wants to...
I guess, or they start talking about it and like, that sounds cool. I'll give it a try.
Yeah, okay. Like Honig and...
Yeah. That's kind of...
Honig, Rosin, Jacobs.
Matthews.
Yep.
Walt. W.
I was going to say it sounds like a like midlife crisis, but Rosin's like the oddball in that one.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That's good, though.
If you story about Rosin.
Yeah.
A very funny.
He's a funny guy.
He is a funny guy.
But yeah, that's good.
Yeah, that's saying. What else? So you saw Alien Romulus? Oh, so it's been a very controversial film.
I've heard good and bad reviews.
I've heard good, like, bad, and average. I've heard the whole gamut.
My notes.
Oh, let's go.
Wow.
Let's go.
Yes.
Let's go.
I enjoyed it.
Okay.
I guess the first, I'd give it an 8 out of 10.
8 out of 10?
With all those notes?
Yeah.
Yes. Holy shit.
Okay.
Yeah. I enjoyed it. The thing that I've found kind of watching it, you know, took some of these notes like right after the movie. And, you know, then I wanted to watch a couple of videos, people who liked it, people who didn't like it. I wanted to kind of consider their positions. Mm-hmm. And
you do your research.
I'm kind of pissed off. A lot of people didn't like.
I'm surprised you didn't say ticked.
Yeah. I am. You know what
grinds my gears? No. So like, Prometheus and Covenant came out, and there was a lot of gnashing of teeth. People going, "This isn't an alien movie." Blah 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 blah. And then Fede Alvarez comes along and gives us an alien movie, a very fan centric, and there's a balance of nostalgia baiting and respecting what came before. And I think he did, you know, probably 8 out of 10, you know, points. Does it right on the nose, respects and understands and recreates a aesthetic and environment and a feel of Aliens, in a sense. And I hear a lot of these people complaining that, oh, this is just rehash. This is blah, blah, blah.
So I've heard a lot of that too. It reminds me, and I haven't seen it, mm-hmm. so I'll take my, you know, I'm just, the comments remind me of kind of what I saw after episode 7. Mm-hmm. Of like people comparing it with A New Hope, and but nobody's saying that it's just a piece of shit, but some people saying like it doesn't do enough new stuff, it doesn't move push enough new ground, it just feels like a retread of episode 4.
And this what this is that that line what makes me so angry, because Prometheus and Covenant did exactly that.
Right, right, right.
And there was, I like Prometheus. And there was gnashing of teeth
about
it. That's
what I was going to say. I said, you're never going to make everybody happy, right?
Right.
And the thing is, what do you want? Like, one thing about it is, what do you want? We want new... Well, when they gave it to you, you said it wasn't true to the source material. And they
say there's two things that most people hate. Things changing and things staying the same.
Exactly. Yes. And that's what it boils down to when it comes to these legacy movies, I believe, is you don't... You're so focused on nostalgia, and when they give you all this nostalgia, mm-hmm. oh, it's just a rehash of what we already know. I wish they'd done something different. Well, when they do something different,
this isn't what I know.
This isn't what I know. Yeah, exactly. So,
it's one weird. It's one thing that if they take, I haven't watched Acolyte, the Star Wars thing, nor has most of people, because I just saw this morning they're not getting a second season.
It's in the notes.
Yep. Okay, we'll get there. So someone from outside of that world tries to create something and kind of doesn't get it and breaks it. All right, I get the, you know, sour grapes about that. But this is Ridley Scott coming in and doing Covenant and Prometheus and like fleshing out the world, adding more depth to it.
The world they created.
The world they created. Giving you answers to, like, we watched Prometheus last night, and I showed my wife, I was like, right there, they told us, you know, we had the space jockey for 30-some years wondering what it was. Mm-hmm. Here, in the climax of Prometheus, oh, it's a gun to kill people. That's to kill their creations. They gave us an answer. And then they fleshed out all these other things.
Yeah. I loved the engineers and the whole, I loved it.
Yeah, and it was a question that had been lingering on people's minds, and they gave us the. So I think it was great, and this is also Ridley Scott is a part of this. So I think he, you know, not in every way, had a little bit of humble pie and was like, let's give them what they ask for this time, and here it is.
Do you think that a big part of that is people building up these expectations themselves, and you're never going to live up to these expectations you set for the screenwriters and the developers? You know, like when I say, what do you want? People don't know what the fuck they want. They just have these lofty expectations of what they think the next phase should be. And when Ridley Scott, for example, goes and does it, and for all intents and purposes, hits it on the mark, it's just not what. I don't know what people want.
Yeah, I think when certain things become so iconic and the impact is such a part of the fabric of the culture, it's so hard to please everybody because you've made the audience so big.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, and now that the audience is so big, the chances of you pleasing them twice is fucking one in a million. It is Aliens. It is Empire Strikes Back. It is Terminator 2. It is Godfather 2. It is Two Towers. Mm-hmm. Dawn of the Planet of the Apes. Like, there's a few that do it, but it's so fucking hard. And the further you go, the harder it gets.
Exactly. Yeah. Which is why I think a lot of you'll see people who cut off franchises like right there. Hey, let your imagination fill in the blanks for you.
Oh,
You know?
Yep.
Aliens is definitely that way of people, you know, referring to Alien and Aliens as the only Alien movies. I'm like, unfortunately, there was three, and I liked Resurrection.
I actually like Resurrection.
So it's, I think that is probably the number one controversy coming out of this.
Yeah.
Number two.
Laid on me.
Is definitely... spoiler here.
Okay.
Ian Holm appearing in this movie. So they pulled
that name means nothing to me.
That's so, the guy from Aliens.
Yeah, Alien.
Alien.
He played Ash, the android.
Okay. Got it.
Right. Okay. Yeah. He died in 2020.
Oh.
Oh, so he really is an android in this.
So yeah. There was the whole kind of deep fake kind of thing.
How did they do it?
Yes, they did it. So there's a undergirders to this story. They did it deep fake kind of. They had an actor and they schlacked that.
Did Leia in Rogue One.
Exactly.
And, yeah.
Without the Disney money, because I'm... it looks like they got the proportions wrong or something. It looks like he looks like a tiny person head. It looks weird. It looks jarring.
Zika virus.
It looks jarring to me. Mm-hmm. Aesthetically. I think it's a shame that they did it that way. I would have preferred them doing it. And I rewatched Alien 3. The Bishop.
Uh-huh.
What is an android? Essentially an animatronic head.
Mm-hmm.
And they did it well. It was like the only thing, I think, in retrospect, looking back on Alien 3, that they did well. They brought a damaged Bishop, and it was obviously animatronic, but it was believable, and it was a practical effect. And Fede was big on practical effects. I think, now, I'll get to why I think they did it the way they did. I think that they should have just done a practical effect head of the old Ash. It's Rook, Rook Bishop. That's totally fitting. Right. Totally fitting canon. But they did it in such a way. I think they needed to do it because he was kind of like the, I'm going to tell you what's happening on the station, and I'm going to be the bad android that's going to trick you. And that's a trope in Alien. So it's needed there. I just think that the CGI was abysmal, and that was the only CGI that was abysmal. The stuff they did in outer space.
Terrific.
Beautiful.
Where does this take place?
So this takes place on,
Timeline wise.
Oh, timeline. It is what? 20 some years after the original Alien. And like that puts it about 30 some. And I went back on all this of like, it is, some people were arguing. So, I'll finish my statement.
Yeah.
30 some years before Alien. So it is right in between the first and the second movie. And it does it, you know, it respects the aesthetic. The sound design is all from, they actually went and found the actual sounds from the original movie and put it in there. There was some argument about like what android should be in there. And it is definitely Rook Ash in terms of the timeline, because at that time he's like a 20-year-old model.
Mm-hmm.
If you wanted to put in David from Prometheus, you're looking at like a 50-year-old model. And Bishop wasn't around at that point in the timeline, so he would be cutting edge. So
yeah.
Now, the background to why they use this CGI on this face. Fede Alvarez and Ridley Scott went to Ian Holm's family and approached them to say, hey, can we do this? The family was like, yes, we think that he would like this because in his last few years of life, he had complained that he felt Hollywood had forgotten about him and wasn't picking him up on things. And he had talked about wanting to reprise that role at some point. And so the family was on board.
Nice.
And I think that the reason they had to use the actual digital likeness is that's how they paid the family, the estate. Mm-hmm. So like this wasn't, they did it without anyone's permission or they had the right.
It sounds like everything they did here, they did respectfully from top to bottom.
Except actually the execution.
I
do feel that there's a point in there.
General with the movie, with the sounds and the design.
Yeah. There's some plot holes. There's some stuff that'll challenge you. The third act, I'm going to leave that as a, you know, spoiler protected zone. The third act has some controversy for the same kind of people that bicker about Prometheus or bicker about, you know, there's always something to complain. But if you look at it from the big picture, it is a fanboy who respects the film, giving a nod to every single, I think the little thing should have been a nod. The only nod to Alien 3 would have been a practical android. But he respectfully gives nods to everything. He leaves it open. He leaves it open for another movie. He definitely, you know, there's a survivor. So, like, you could do another movie, or you could just, it's a big enough world that you could have another character, have right. another planet, have another alien.
Right.
So all in all, I think it's a result of, you know, we wouldn't have this movie if we didn't have, you know, Prometheus and
Covenant
shutting down before the third one. And they were like, all right, we hear you. We're going to give you facehuggers, chestbursters, alien jump scares, and the alien that you know and want. And, you know, again, it's kind of like reading a comic book of aliens. Like, sometimes you have these stories that are in complete isolation, and it's enjoyable, and it packs it up in a bow. Or you could pick that up next issue with a new leg off that story. So it's not without controversy, but we could have done a lot worse. Seeing as, you know, what Borderlands is abysmal, and you know, all the, what was the Mad Max thing recently didn't do well. So, like,
I didn't see the second one. I didn't mind the first one.
Yeah, I've got nothing against it. It just sounds like it did abysmal at the box office. So, I don't expect another knock out of the park if you just picked up some rando, but for, it's an exciting time to be an Alien fan. Alien Earth, the series, is coming out, spring, summer next year.
I think a lot of people are excited. I'm excited about the premise of that, aliens on Earth.
Yeah, yeah. I'm interested in...
They did that in the comics or the books or something?
Yes, but timeline is the big... The only thing that I have is, you know, if the whole Covenant Prometheus story is, I mean, and it is canon, it is very canon, if that tracks, I'm interested how they're going to have a fleshed out normal alien. Now, if it happens, I have to look at the timeline again, but if it is after Covenant and Prometheus, okay, I'll bite on that. That's theoretically plausible. Yeah, we'll see. I'm totally excited. And yeah, especially after it sounds like it's made $100 million internationally.
Oh, nice. Wow.
$40 million domestically, and the budget was 80.
Okay.
So
it was 80 million?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
That's surprising.
Yeah. So from what I've heard, I mean, I guess that there's a promotional expenses and marketing.
Yeah, usually double it.
Yeah. So, but it'll make its sounds money like back, yeah. which you know, you can count, you know, movies.
Yeah, it's not much these days.
Yeah. So that, you know, if that's any indicator, we'll get another movie. We'll get another theatrical release, Aliens.
Yeah.
And this one was supposed to be originally a Hulu. Like Prey being on Hulu and knocking it out of the park, I think we're probably looking at potentially a, you know, if it's Trachtenberg who did Prey, getting a theatrical release, we'll probably get a theatrical release regardless of how Aliens Earth does. So yeah, an exciting time to be a fan in terms of, you know, movies and films being made by people who respect the intellectual property, who are fans and want to cheer it on. And that seems to be missing from Star Wars, from Marvel, from you name it.
Yep.
So this is one of those few times that as an Alien fan, I'm like, yeah.
I saw Chucky over the weekend.
Oh, yeah.
And I did a drip check.
How could you not?
How could you not? I'm going to pull the photo up, but I did a drip check on him. And I was like, how much did that ensemble cost you? And I think it was just, so now including the watch, sunglasses, you know, the whole shebang.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
$2,500?
Yeah, I'm around there. Holy shit. I'm around there.
Man, you do that money.
Now, I want to say when I saw him.
A $30 pair of underwear. So, I mean
that adds up.
That's nice.
I was like, look at this motherfucker. You know, as he's walking up and he's like, I was in a look at me kind of mood.
I got out of bed and said, you know what? I just want people to look at me.
Dude, that's awesome. everything you put on, like, you didn't like grab something from
those are
so the boots are custom, they're $700.
Yeah.
And who was the company that makes them?
JK Boots.
JK, of, just kidding, Boots.
Yeah, out of they're out of Spokane, Washington.
We'll make some custom. I'm sorry.
So my foot size.
Okay, there you go. I just didn't know if you like designed them from.
It's all like it's cobbled. Like literally cobbler.
You look like a created character on a RPG, by the way.
Yeah. You know, their hand. So I had to send my measurements in, and they're hand built.
Have you used them before?
Have I used them?
The company.
No. I went down a rabbit hole on. There's this YouTube channel that I kind of go, and I'll send you a link, Bobby, because
I watched the Yeezy one with okay. you at when we were together.
Oh yeah, yeah. Rose Anvil. It's a leather working company. It seems like their biggest product is like leather straps for cameras. They make wallets, yada, yada. Go check out their website. Check out their YouTube because basically what he did during COVID was cut apart shoes. So he gets either shoes sent to them or he buys shoes. And he's a leather worker, so he's kind of interested in the construction of these things. And so he cuts them apart and looks at them and compares and contrasts. And he has, to date, cut apart over around $100,000 worth of shoes. So he'll cut anything.
Yeah, Rose Anvil?
Yeah, Rose Anvil. Like he cuts apart $1,000 Lucchese's, cowboy boots, Yeezys. What were those? Big old red boots.
The Astro Boy boots.
Yeah. He cut apart those. He cuts apart. He's big into, you know, the Pacific Northwest, high quality leather boots. He went down a rabbit hole of like World War II, like GI boots, Nazi boots, you name it. Like cut them apart and go
Das what? Boot.
Das boot. Cut apart Das boot. This big submarine, but wanted to see what was in the inside of it. But yeah, cuts them apart, looks at them, and he's well versed in the construction of shoes. And
would he be able to say, like, does he, when he does this, does he say, oh, this is made like shit?
Or yeah, you know, yeah. Really? Okay. Well, and so that was one of the things with like these Lucchese's, which are known as a very top tier cowboy boot,
also a top tier crime family.
Yeah. So. And he's like, for you so know,
let's speak respectfully.
Well, and there's some other shoe that's recent. It's like it's got a star on the side of it.
Converse.
No, Golden Goose.
Golden Goose. Yes, mm-hmm. He cuts apart a pair of Golden Goose shoes, and he's like, for $600, what are you getting out of this?
Golden Goose are the ultimate white girl shoe.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
So
yeah.
They're designer shoes. That's why they're so expensive.
Yep.
But he's like, you buy them dirty.
Yes.
They come dirty.
I wish your motherfucker would.
My wife wants a pair, right? She fits the demographic.
Oh, yeah.
And I was like, why don't you just, and I won't buy them for her.
Yeah.
I was like, but I will buy you a nice pair of shoes. And then over time, they can get dirty on their own.
Yeah.
And then you can wear those dirty shoes.
Yeah. Because he cuts them apart.
$600.
Yeah.
Oh, over $600.
Yeah. They're designer.
He's starting
he,
it.
He cuts
like,
them apart.
They're Tyson's. Like, you know, like that's like, you know, Neiman Marcus and shit like that. Like, you can't just get them anywhere.
Right.
Holy shit.
And is there value there other than the brand? And that's what he does to a lot of shoes. And short answer to that is no. He's like, the construction of these is easily a $190 shoe. That's where it should align with price point. But you're paying for
name and exclusivity.
Brand. Yep. So it's kind of a cool anything. Kind of a cool little thing. And you go down a rabbit hole, he does these, you know, 10, 15 minute videos, and then you just get hooked. And he cut apart the JK boots, and he's cut apart a couple of them. He's like, these are hands down the burliest boots that are out there, like full leather, heavy leather construction. He's like, they are like logger boots.
Right.
And I had leather boots in the past, but like glued soles. the vegan with the leather boots, I wanted
to, ew, meat.
I wanted
you're vegan too, aren't you?
I'm not.
Oh, you're not?
No,
I thought you were. You at some point?
I was vegetarian. I was never vegan.
Oh, vegetarian. Are you still vegetarian?
No.
That's been what a while. I'm talking about.
But the boots are great. And I just wanted something that could be resold, was handcrafted. Like, because I have a pair of leather boots. They're like military surplus boots. And they're great, the uppers, but it's a glued-on sole. So, like, once that's gone, like, that's it. And I was like, I want something that is going to be broken in, and I've got these for a lifetime if I care for them. And the JK boots are.
Then he had a $150 hat on. $170 hat on.
$175 cowboy hat.
$1,000 watch.
Stetson.
$1,000 watch.
Yes. Yeah. You know, Garmin with the heart rate and the connected to the phone.
I guess that's important.
That one, it was
fine.
Is it the one that you can activate the helicopter for you?
Mm-hmm. It has like skydiving and like night vision modes and military. It'll like.
But isn't there one that like if you have a medical emergency, you can like summon a helicopter, a rescue helicopter. Like if you're like out, if you're out in the desert somewhere, you can like hit like a boop and they like launch. You have to pay for the helicopter.
I think I would imagine you could get that as an app because there's companies that offer those location services, and you buy this little thing and hook it on. It's motorcycle. Some adventure riders have it, and yeah, it does exactly that.
So yeah, you were out there stunting on them.
You got a luxury lifestyle, man.
Yeah, I was in there. I was in there subtle at about 1300. I was in the room subtle at around 1300 subtly.
My God, guys.
And then it was, but I could just look at Chucky O, and I know it's not in my wheelhouse, but I knew it was money.
A different kind of money.
Different kind.
So I just started asking a couple questions here and there. And then as soon as I got enough little details surrounding the ensemble, I was like, what's the total money on this ensemble? Yeah. You know what I mean? And when he said that, I was like, fuck, man. Like, you're fucking killing it out here.
And it's really just those boots. Those boots were...
And the watch.
Yeah.
The boots, the watch, and the hat.
But so like, I think nowadays... The amount of people that are going to spend $1,000 on a smartwatch is much closer to the bell curve average than someone spending $700.
I don't know. I don't have one.
I don't have one either.
I bought one for my wife a couple years ago.
I did too. I just don't. I don't need any more ways for you to get in touch with me.
Yeah. My thing, I carry this around with me everywhere.
Same.
And there's little to no chance I'm not going to.
And I wish I carried this less.
Yeah, same. I'm the same way.
So
You're horrible.
Yeah, yeah. Well,
you're horrible at communication. You're horrible at keeping in touch. You're horrible.
But it gets better because my phone broke over the end of July, and I did the whole like insurance because I was like, man, I just, you know, money's coming in, money's going out, and I was like, man, I don't want to spend $800 on a phone right now. So I had the little insurance thing on. I was like, great. Great, they'll replace my phone. They'll replace my phone in 2 weeks.
Right.
And so I did not have a phone for 2 weeks. And it was a good time.
Yeah.
Good time.
Yeah.
Calls and stuff. No one calling me when I didn't want to talk. And, you know, and a good excuse for why I didn't answer text messages. I mean, I didn't have a phone. Sorry, man.
I think it's bizarre as fuck that you can just see a text message and just make a decision of, I'm just not responding. Like, I could never. I'm too worried about, like, being polite.
I've tried to do that, but it doesn't work.
I can't do it.
No more than 5 minutes.
I can't do it. Chucky O will just, I'll send him a text message, and he will just decide, like nope. That's not going to be one I get to today.
It's usually like, I got five other things. What's going on? That. File that away. You got to respond to that.
And then forget
about it.
Put that on that.
That's exactly what happens.
So you claim.
That's exactly what happens.
Anything else new and exciting in the world of Chucky O?
Yeah, motorcycle stuff, boots, movies. No, not a whole lot.
All right.
Life's been good.
All right. Did you watch Dragons? No, House of Dragons?
Negative.
Okay. All right. Just checking.
I did.
What did you think of the finale? Or the last episode, maybe, is what I should call it.
I know what you're saying. It wasn't a finale.
No.
It was a preview for next season.
Yeah.
That's the best way I can put it.
I mean, they got us. Like, people were saying, like, the last three episodes was like a three hour trailer for season three. Uh-huh.
I can see that. And yeah, it's...
That episode four, though, and that shit with the dragon fight.
That was good.
That was good.
And you had high expectations on that. They were going to build off of it. It was going to just escalate. But no, it's...
And the fact you got to wait two years.
Yes,
man. It's like... Just like waiting for a fucking Star Wars movie back when Lucas had it.
Mm-hmm. It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
So, but
what's new otherwise? Plants?
Actually, I'm going after I leave here. I'm going to
check the spot.
Check the spot after I leave here because I don't get out this way very often. Yeah, so it's got to be intentional.
Yeah.
plants are good, man. I love it. I've tried to get rid of a couple. I'm cleaning some house, but you know, it's good. I got a new setup and I'm just seeing how that rolls. Things are good. Works good. That's been cool.
Watching anything?
So no. Yeah, kinda. I'm going to start probably today. There's a new Batman series called Cape Crusader.
Yeah. I haven't watched it. I've heard good things about it, though.
So I want to sit down and I'm going to watch that. I can't remember the last time I've been here, but
that original series is so fucking good, man. What? Like the Batman animated series.
Oh my goodness.
It's just like, it's so perfectly done. I can execute it.
I would love to rewatch that whole series too.
Yeah, I would too. I'd love to watch it with my kids. They don't give a fuck.
So I'm going to start that today, but I caught season 4 of Umbrella Academy, which was disappointing.
Yeah, I couldn't get into that shit, man.
First two seasons I liked. But it's just that the last two just, and especially this last one, just kind of fell off. And it was, and this was the series finale.
Okay.
And I'm like, oh, they just, it was just,
it's hard to close.
Yeah, it is.
It's hard to close, dude.
They didn't have to work too hard to close it. It just,
you know, I think about shows where I'm like, man, great, great closure. You know, I can't think of all that many. I think the show called Six Feet Under. That was probably the best closure I've ever seen of a television show in my life. Probably the best. Are you familiar with that show?
I haven't watched it. I know what you're talking about.
Early 2000s HBO, right? HBO?
Yeah. So like the beginning of every episode opens with a death. Never, not always, right? But not usually with a character that you know, just some rando. You just opens it up. My wife and I used to play a game and we watched it, be like, all right, guess, you know, the demographics. And, we'd be like, all right, haven't seen an Asian dude yet. Let's go Asian, mid-30s, female, you know, and then like see if we could get it right or not. And then when they died, the screen would go black. And the name would come up with the birth year and the death year of that person, and then the episode would start, right? In the fucking final episode, all the characters' arcs are kind of wrapped up, summed up, put a bow on it, or a nail in it, depending on the circumstances. And then they go through every surviving character and show how they eventually die.
No shit. That's good.
Phenomenal.
Yeah. I might have to watch that.
It's a long series, but it's so worth it. It's one of the best series
I've
ever seen.
How many seasons?
Five or six.
It's terrible.
Yeah. And it's HBO, so it's only like 13 episodes. Or so, yeah,
it's not terrible,
but that's one. Breaking Bad is one.
Yeah,
that ended.
That came
well
to mind just now when you talked about
it. Oz was okay.
Never watched it.
Sopranos wasn't great.
People still talk about the Sopranos.
Yeah, The Wire was good, but it wasn't amazing. Like the closure of it.
Yeah, yeah,
wasn't amazing, but it was good. It's hard, man.
It's hard to do it when you have the environment that allows for it. I think now in this streaming world, did you see Mindhunter?
I did not, but I heard about it.
It was on Netflix when you still had Netflix.
Yeah, I don't have that anymore.
It was a great two seasons. It was great. It set itself up for another season, and they just killed it. And I think you're seeing more and more of that. I mean, again, Acolyte killed it. But okay. Good. Thank you. But I think that it's just not given the time for a slow boil or something to develop to be able to do it. When you guys talked about the preview, 3-episode preview for the next season, that's where we're at in terms of like Nielsen ratings and going, oh, this episode trended well, this episode trended well. Oh, we got a drop off. Let's build up anticipation for new viewers into the thing. And that's probably the reason behind, 3-episode trailer for the next season is to, they've got to manage those expectations, build up the hype again. And so maybe in some productions like that, I personally wouldn't mind a story that goes one or two seasons and is well wrapped up. Mm-hmm. I don't need necessarily.
I don't mind a one season, dude. Like you think about like the last good thing I saw on Netflix was Dahmer.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And it was one season.
Yeah. Give me a story. And
arguably,
tell it.
Maybe one or two episodes too long, but overall, tight, concise. Told the story, got out.
Yep.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
There's another show. It was called The Corner. is kind of the predecessor to The Wire, based on a true story, the McCullough family that lived in West Baltimore. And I believe it's just one season, and it's only six episodes, I think, yeah, if memory serves. And it just tells a tight, concise story. It gets in, it gets out, and you're left like, fuck, that was great.
Yep.
Well, let me ask you, if mm-hmm. with that being the case, it's one of those, and as you were talking, Chuck, I thought about it, with something like Dragons, do you think because you have that almost guaranteed and built-in fan base and audience, you know that they're going to turn it. I don't care how crappy we get.
Yeah.
They know they've got us by the balls, basically. People are going to turn in.
It's true.
So they can take more chances, and they're willing to disappoint you more. Whereas with, let's say, The Corner, we don't know if this is going to be a hit.
Yeah.
So let's get everything tightened up in one season, make it a great one, and then have people wanting more, like, you know, wanting more.
So I think that's true, but I think there's one other element that's tied into that, and that is the streaming pocket, right? So they get the money for The Corner, they shoot The Corner, they wrap The Corner, they produce The Corner, the Corner achieves whatever level of success it achieved, which wasn't a ton, but it was kind of those, like, the people that know, you know? Then they put The Corner out on DVD, and then the DVD sells, you know, fair.
Yeah.
And then that's how they make their money, right? But now everything is about keeping you on the platform.
Like,
that's the goal. The goal is to keep you on HBO Max or Netflix or whatever, or Amazon Prime or whatever the case is, for as long as possible. And I think that's why we get, and Dragons is a little unique because there are things that it has to set up. Like, it's a more complicated story, so it has to do it. But, like, a lot of this shit, like, you can tell, it's like, man, fuck, this shit should have been four episodes, and it's fucking 10, because they want to keep you on the platform for as long as possible for their data.
Maybe that's why they don't tell you ahead of time, like, when we're going to premiere a show, hey, this is going to be a one season show or a five season show. Like, because they'll tell you after they've already got you hooked as a viewer, hey, season five is going to be the last one, and you're only on season three. Okay,
cool. I might as well finish it.
Yeah, and so I would love to know going into this, hey, it's going to be four seasons of this show, or two seasons.
Well, and the other thing they don't want to do is if that first one comes out as a fucking smash, they're like, better make it eight seasons.
Yeah. Well, so like The Expanse, great sci-fi series. If you read the books, you're like, all right, I know we're looking at five or six seasons based on the books. Like, what do we got? And they wander through and then cut it at three or four, and someone else has to pick it up. Like, that's that's when you're saved. But I think a lot of these streaming services, especially Netflix, just doesn't have the patience. And if something isn't, you know,
popping
first, you know, second, third, like trending well.
The slow burn isn't allowed anymore.
Correct. No.
Like that word of mouth of like, man, have you heard about this fucking show?
Yeah, this is great.
I'm on season two, and it's that you never hear that anymore.
And that kills some really good shows that only made it. Like, take Mindhunter, for example. Two seasons, they're great, but there's some things that I just won't get involved with if I know if I'm left hanging,
closure.
Why do I want to get into that story?
Yeah.
Otherwise, so it's an unfortunate place where we exist in this streaming world, where I think that we're left with more of these shows on the cutting room floor of your television set because they're moving on to the next.
Yeah. Everybody's vying for your attention. Like you said, Netflix, Prime, HBO, Peacock, they're all vying for your attention.
So but now there's this whole movement of like a tier system. Like, they've got you, you're not leaving.
Now are you the peasant?
Yeah.
Are you the middle class, or are you the premier client?
Because I was
I'm the peasant watching, all of them.
Watching Prometheus last night on Disney, and I'm like, why the fuck do I have a commercial in something I'm paying for? And because I don't think
the system is working.
Yeah.
Yeah. And they're scrambling.
Yep. And it's like, oh, well, we need to milk our existing customers for more money.
Yeah, I do not like commercials in my streaming service. I feel like that's the reason we all streaming.
Right.
That's the whole that was a whole selling
point. But it's not paying the bills.
Correct. Yeah. So we got to do so.
So it's the same that, like, Matt Damon did that interview recently where he was talking about why you don't see so many, like, just regular good movies anymore. Mm-hmm. And he was like, because DVDs used to be part of the sales plan for a movie.
Yeah.
And now that you can't make money that way off DVDs, you either got to do Avengers or fucking, you know, you got $800,000 or $80,000 and you try to make a horror movie in your basement.
Wow. That's a shame.
Yeah. It's a weird dynamic that we're in, you know, entertainment wise.
Yeah, I agree. You bought any hot toys or gone on any hot toys recently?
Haven't.
You going to do anything for this new Captain America, Brave and the Bold? Or whatever it is.
As far as what?
Purchasing. Are you planning on going?
I got to see what his
Harrison Ford looks like. Obviously is probably
real. Obviously. You know? Obviously.
I am excited to see Red Hulk.
I'm very excited to see that. Yeah. That's like, because we've all known it was coming. And as morbid as it sounds, I strongly dislike the casting of characters in these big budget movies, because typically what are you going to go for? You're going to go for a well-known actor, you know, and all this stuff.
Get and asses in
the
seats. Hum-
the human aspect of me is like, that motherfucker's like 55, 60, 65 years old.
Yeah.
How
long can he commit?
How long? Yeah, I even think the same thing when it comes to like Robert Downey Jr. Why are we committing to him playing Doom when I'm not saying he's going to keel over, but it's give younger people a chance, first of all, younger actors, but at the same time, it's like, I can't realistically see this 60-year-old man in this physical role. And I get we have CGI stunt doubles and stuff.
Yeah, that's all it's going
to be. When, like, Red Hulk, I knew he was going to have to be, you know, the fact that William Hurt died before he was able to play it. And he's been, and he's been that character for the better part of 15 years, which is wild.
Yeah.
So it's disappointing a little bit.
I think that I hate that Robert Downey Jr. looks like he's really going to be Doom. I hate that.
I don't like that.
I hate that.
I don't know if you want to talk about that later, but I kind of have a whole
thing.
Yeah, it for me, that was, first of all, it's a cash grab, it's a cop out, and I feel like it's because Marvel has been in a slump for the past several years, it's very much desperation. And I feel like you're throwing the baby out with the bathwater when it comes to the possibilities of that universe, and you're just going back to what somebody you know is going to make you money, or that name recognition. Oh, my God, he's back. He had the perfect ending. We talked about that. He had the perfect ending for his character.
Yep.
Yeah.
And I feel like I could go years, the rest of Marvel's lifetime or mine, without seeing Robert Downey Jr. in a Marvel role again.
Yeah, agreed.
Because his character arc perfect. Was wrapped up.
Yeah.
And now we're going back because they were scrambling. And I feel like that is a mistake they made, and
it's a bunch of pander bears.
It really is.
It's like
you could pick anybody else.
Yeah,
to, like they could have. If you're gonna spend RDJ money,
they
could
buy.
You could get somebody else.
They were talking about whatever his name is, Kylo Ren as Doom. Like I think he would have been.
It would have been. Give him
great.
A chance at least. Oh, yeah. You know. You know? Or, I think
the fact that he starts off without having like a Hollywood face makes it even better.
Yes, exactly. And while I do feel like eventually and hopefully they do bring Jonathan Majors back as Kang, because I think that
I hope they do.
I feel like there's so much left on the table with that, and I get the drama with him outside, but I feel like there's so much there.
Disney's just weird, man. Like where they choose to like draw a line in the sand and say you're out. Like Jonathan Majors hurt that girl. That's what he got, right? Like, but it was like third degree assault or some shit. It's like when you hurt somebody and you don't mean to hurt them, right? But even that, it wasn't like somebody beating a girl. Like, you know what I mean? It wasn't like a monstrous thing. It was just like, it was like a lover's quarrel.
Correct.
You know, and I'm sure he regrets it now. I do think that he has done some goofy ass shit since the whole stage fight that he broke up and all that bullshit. I'm like, no wonder Marvel hired him. This guy's acting his ass off. I don't think that he's done anything so egregious. I feel the same way about fucking Carano and the fucking Mandalorian shit. You know what I mean? Where she, you know, she basically, what did she say? She said something silly. I mean, it's dumb. Like what she compared, I think she compared
vaccines or something.
I think it was even like if you do, like, I think she was comparing liberals to Nazis. So I think what she was ultimately doing.
Okay.
Funny thing is the fact that we can't immediately recall what she did.
Yeah.
It's not that, but go ahead.
Yeah. And she was kind of had a stance on like men are men and women are women and that sort of a thing. Okay. And she said those sorts of things and they fucking
blacklisted
her. Yeah. They tried to, get her to do an apology. She wouldn't do it, you know. And then they're like, "All right, well, go sit out in the cold."
Disney is weird about that kind of thing, considering their history. Yeah. All things considered,
well, like, that might be part of it.
It might the super apology tour,
trying to swing
like,
so far back the other way.
And that pendulum, it bothers me. So to get back to, I would prefer Jonathan Majors as Kang. Of course, come back.
He
and
was great.
Guess what? If he was, and his acting chops were showing on that one, like I'm not a fan of recasting him, only because he owned that role. Yeah. He was so good in that role.
And he looks Kang-ish.
Like that motherfucker.
Once again, not a Hollywood face.
Yeah, exactly. He nailed it, right? Yeah. So to get back to it, it's just, I don't like that they're pivoting so far now that they lured Robert Downey Jr. back with a bag of money and said, hey, you can be Doom. You know, I don't buy the variant shit. Let's just.
Yeah.
I was at the tip of the spear saying Marvel was losing it. I want to go out and say it. It's documented here. I was the first one saying, like, they ain't got it anymore.
I recall you saying.
And people telling me I was out of my mind.
Right.
The last 5 years have been rough.
Yeah.
And so I'm still a Marvel fan. I really am.
I'm still a fan.
I'm hoping. Like, I saw.
Love Deadpool.
Yeah. I saw Deadpool.
I'm aware of its flaws. I think some people are not aware of its flaws, which kind of irritates me. Yeah. Like, the story of the movie is weak.
Okay.
It's weak. And the plot holes are enormous.
Have you talked about
it's so much fun. Mm-hmm. That I'm willing to overlook it because of how much of a good time I had.
See, I feel like we see very similarly on that because I was in them. I enjoyed it.
Mm-hmm.
I enjoyed it. I told myself, even in the moment, I was like, I might watch this one more time, like at home on streaming, and then it's done. I'm not raving about it. I enjoyed it, but I was able to see that the story's kind of weak. The plot holes, all that. But I like Gambit. Favorite character in them.
Same.
Like I don't know why, but
and he nailed that shit.
I would watch that shit just for him.
I hope he gets a movie.
He has to get a movie.
Yeah,
because that was my favorite part of
this.
This
has been Gambit's
movie.
Year.
Yeah,
yeah. And so, between this and that cartoon,
remember it.
It has been Gambit's year.
Yeah, and so if they're not doing something with him, I don't know.
They can't read the writing on the wall, and that's part of their problem. Of
agreed.
You know,
and don't Disney this motherfucker up like. You saw that true to form Gambit works both in animated and in live action.
Yep.
Just stick to what he is.
Yeah, give him a goddamn cigarette.
Yeah.
I've had it. The bloody liberal media not letting my characters have cigarettes.
They're not going to do it. Like, because wasn't that an issue with Wolverine, too?
The cigars. Yeah. They took them out of the toys.
Yeah.
You know, you know what I mean? You got to buy a third party cigar for your fucking Logan.
Yep.
Wow.
So, it's whatever. Speaking of Marvel, I'm looking forward to, I think they're doing a Marvel vs. Capcom set or something like that as far as like downloadable set or whatever. If you're a fan of the games.
Yeah, for what?
It's going to be on PlayStation 4.
Oh.
For what game?
Is it like...
So I have it here.
So are they putting out are they re-releasing the game or are they putting like skins on other characters?
No, it's Marvel vs. Capcom Fighting Collection Arcade Classics.
Oh, wow.
So it's going to be...
That's fucking cool.
I'll tell you which ones it is.
Those games were kind of a mess to play, in my opinion, but they looked so great.
Yeah,
they are
beautiful.
My favorite game. So it's going to start with X-Men Children of the Atom fighting game, Marvel Super Heroes, X-Men versus Street Fighter, Marvel Super Heroes versus Street Fighter.
Was Children of the Atom like the side-scrolling?
No, that was a fighting game, I believe.
Oh, okay.
Then Marvel versus Capcom. That would be. I think that's on a different set.
Yeah, that's the old Capcom. Yeah.
And it's going to close out with Marvel vs. Capcom 2, which had the greatest playlist, like the soundtrack. And then The Punisher is going to be like an added, the side-scroller.
Oh, fucking cool.
So,
wow.
That comes out this... Later, so I think they said August, September. So I'm really looking forward to that.
Yeah, that's cool.
Nice. Obviously, I was looking it up earlier.
Yeah. I asked you about the Hot Toys because I ended up going in on one or two recently, and then I was like, oh, fuck, I'll go get this one.
Did you get the Falcon?
So, no, I didn't.
Well, Captain America, I'm sorry, my bad.
I have my Falcon and I have my Cap.
Okay.
I'm only doing one in one. But I am going, I did get Sidious from episode 3.
Okay.
Because why not? and I did what else did I got? I got the Wolverine from Deadpool Wolverine with the mask.
Okay.
And I want to say I went in on one. I went in on one more. Yeah. Well, to get it unmasked was like the bonus edition. It was like an extra $100, and I was like, I'm probably gonna use the mask anyway because that's what I've been waiting fucking 30 years. Or
unmasked
20 years
is bonus.
Unmasked is bonus. It comes unmasked is the bonus because it comes with both.
Okay.
Along with a couple other things.
That's funny because usually the mask would be the bonus.
Yes, because it's the less detailed one and it kind of can throw it in. But nope, it was the other way. And I'm guessing because they were yeah, counting on people wanting him unmasked. But they fucked with the wrong one with me. I want the mask, so I got the cheap one. And then I ended up getting a few. And then my Anakin just arrived this week from episode 2. So I got him on my Padme shelf, and they're done. I guess like this year I have been like putting buttons in little shelves here and there. It's been nice.
That's good.
Yeah.
I think because you said something, I've been actually considering Hot Toys and whatnot recently. So I got to get back on the sites and make my wish list again.
Yeah.
Get back into it, because it's between that and I was.
Well, now you're making more money.
Well, I mean, just a little bit more.
Just a little bit. Yeah.
And now, no payment plans for me.
My plan is one payment.
Right.
Today.
All of it. yeah, so I'm looking at that, but also different newer Lego sets, and I'm kind of looking for something with that. So
yeah.
We'll see.
But that's cool.
It's been good, man. It's been a great few months. Doing a lot of work around the house, and you know.
Oh, at the house, okay.
And on myself.
Yeah,
and
okay, fair enough. I'm sure it's in some new book you bought.
I'm not going to say I'm doing a lot of work at
success
work.
Success starts with me.
Yes.
All right, well, I got a couple things. First of all, I should go ahead and talk about this fucking... Oh, let's talk about this. So Chucky O and I were together this weekend at Boar's kids' birthday party.
Uh-huh.
Huh.
I think they invited...
The kid invited you, or...?
No. Okay. Leia and him play together when we go to Boar Bash.
Okay.
And then I think his wife invited my wife, and then my wife was like, look, we don't have anything going on. So I was like, all right, let's go on up there.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, I say all that to say this. I saw Chucky O throw shade in a very Chucky O way. I was a big fan of it. So, all right. So here's what happened. There was a woman there who was having a fucking meltdown. Grown-ass woman. Hmm. Having a complete fucking meltdown.
Kid's birthday party.
Yeah. Over a honeybee. Like a bumblebee. Like just your normal standard bee that you see. Right? I don't know bees, but this wasn't anything special.
Wasn't Africanized?
No, I didn't say Wu-Tang symbol. Killer bee. Those are the killer bees. But like, it's just standard, your standard bee. And this motherfucker came around her, and she started jerking like a epileptic with her hands curled up in her chest like a T-Rex.
Yep.
And then started like verbally like, no, no, no.
Like the bee, no! Like the bee heard it. It's like, oh, geez.
So I was like, you allergic? She was like, oh yeah. Didn't find out till I was 16, and I could tell she wanted to tell the story, but I wasn't interested, so I didn't cry. And then the bee is still circling her. She gets up, she runs into an open field.
Because that's what you do.
And then is like, carrying on. And
stepped on a hornet's nest or something. That'd have been
and you know what? That would have probably been, because I've had that happen. I took a chainsaw to a hornet's nest and I got swarmed with those suckers. It sucked. Her reaction would have been appropriate for that. Not one that bee looking around at her food.
So here was here goes Chucky O. Chucky O says, bees don't really bother me. He just says it. He just offers that up. Bees don't really bother me. And then we just sort of let that hang there for a bit. And then he goes, well, they bother me a little bit. But. Wait, look. I have coping mechanisms.
That's awesome.
And that shit was funny as hell.
Oh, yeah.
Funny as hell. Let me see if there's anything else that I got.
Like
I got to talk. Oh, I watched a new show last night. It's in my notes. B with a coping mechanism. Nice. I watched a new show last night. Episode 1. Okay. Just started. Released Sunday. It's the same folks that brought you The Tiger King.
Nice.
And it's called something like Love with Chimps. So
it's like an AIDS documentary.
I've watched. have you ever heard the Ricky Gervais bit about that?
No.
Oh God, it's so good. So he's like AIDS. You know, got it in Africa. You know, came from Africa because someone ate a bit of monkey meat and had some AIDS in it, and you know, I'm sure that what happened was you know, a guy showed up and wasn't feeling well. Showed up to the doctor's office, and the doctor was like, Well, we have your results in. And looks like you fucked the monkey. and he was like, what? And the doctor was like, well, you have HIV, which is only present in monkeys, and the only way to get it is sexually transmitted, so looks like you fucked a monkey. I mean, is there any other way it could have happened? And he's like, well, I guess if you had killed a monkey and you were going to cook him and you chopped him up into little monkey meat and you nicked your finger and a little bit of monkey blood got in your finger, then you could get it. Oh, it was that one. It was that one. He also did this. I've told this one before, but another one of my favorite bits of his is he was sitting there eating a bowl of cereal, right? Had the milk in front of him. Back of the milk has this missing girl on it. Blonde hair, blue eyes, you know, happy all the time, you know. So he just logged in his memory or something, you know. So anyway, he's doing a shoot. This shoot is in this old, like, industrial park, and they finish up the shoot for this movie, and he looks down, and through a tattered window of a industrial building that looks abandoned, there's a bed with a little girl chained on it. And he's like, blonde hair, blue eyes, happy all the time. Clearly wasn't her. Clearly wasn't her. I left it.
2 out of 3.
Yeah. The only other thing that I have of real noteworthiness, because this might be a shorter show today, is Fans Toys, the third-party company, third-party transformer company, Chuck Yeo, very popular third-party transformer company, arguably the most popular, released their fifth member of their combiner team for Superion. Let me try to fill you in. So there was a group of Autobots. They were called the Aerialbots. Five of them all turned into jets, and then they also turned into a giant robot together. One made the torso, one made the limbs, and one made a limb, another made a limb, on down the line. Right. So four bots, four limbs, and one torso. So this shit started 5 or 6 years ago.
I was still buying Transformers.
Evan was still buying Transformers when it started. And my theory, there's been all sorts of rumors and conspiracies and everything else. My theory is that it simply didn't work. And they just needed to redesign and redesign and redesign until they got it to work. But over the course of that, we got three figures almost back to back within like probably a year and a half. And then we got a fourth figure at the top of this year. And then we got the fifth figure this past week. So it took all this time to get this thing finished. And it looks great. I've combined it. I've done my review. It's stable.
Oh, you've already got.
Yep.
Okay.
So I'm gonna show a couple of things just to you guys. I can find it. Hold on. So if I just go to my IG here and then... All right, so here's a picture of them combined.
Okay. Uh-huh.
And there's a little A stance.
Uh-huh.
Yep. This is about as far as you can get the legs apart.
Okay.
Then do the full Van Damme?
So the legs are engineered to do the full Van Damme.
Okay.
But I'm going to show you the problem with it. There's another one. You can see the legs are still about the same width apart. Mm-hmm. Different pose, but about the same width apart. And there he is just standing straight up and down.
Uh-huh.
It is overall a pretty good thing. Okay. But this company has just zealots for fans. religious zealots is the only way I can describe them. Like, they can't do any wrong if I point out a criticism.
Yeah.
So I say in my review, and it just published today, so I'm not exactly sure how it's going over quite yet. I've been feeling too good about myself to step into the comments. But I think it's a good thing overall. I think overall it's a good thing. But it has this limitation, and people aren't talking about it, right? Because it's this zealot fan base. So this is what I put at the very last bit of my final thoughts. This is the very last bit, all right?
Oh, shit.
Not very far at all.
Are they going to get you?
I know. I know.
Pitchforks and torches coming out.
I know. And my thing is that, like, I still don't think it's bad. You know, and I think for most people, what they want it to do, which is to just stand there and look imposing,
it doesn't.
But what irritates me is that this thing took as long as it did, and it still can't really do it. Hmm. It does it a little bit. And the little bit that it does great.
I say, good enough.
But once,
get it out.
But once you push it past that,
wow,
then it crumbles.
That shit's funny.
So is it a function of like the leg joint, or is
it's the amount of weight that sit on the hips.
Okay.
And the ratchets that are in the hips are not strong enough to support the weight once they go beyond a certain angle when the center of gravity isn't underneath
How do the ratchets feel in general?
They feel great.
Really?
Yeah. Mm-hmm, they do.
So it doesn't feel like weak ratchets?
Nope.
Okay.
It's just heavy as fuck. It's a 10-pound figure.
No shit.
Yeah.
Wow.
Okay.
Top heavy?
A little bit, because it's got three up there, two at the bottom.
And you don't think, like, I don't know what the foot pad looks like or really how these really work, but, like, if it had, like, a rubbery...
Like hospital socks?
Yeah.
I think it would help, but I still am not sure it would hold up because it's just so much weight up top.
Mm-hmm. And compared to other comparable...
So, and other comparable ones... It is maybe the most stable in an A stance, like the most secure in an A stance, but it doesn't have some of the posability that some of the other ones do, where they take a little bit more of a balance, they take a little bit more finesse to get them there, but you can get them there.
Right.
This one is, once you go past this pivot point,
just goof.
It's over.
Yeah.
Huh. Curtains.
Huh. It definitely sounds like an engineering problem of, like, I want this part to do well, and, you know... Because, there's trade-offs. You know, trade-offs in terms of posability probably means instability in more of these poses. But if that's what the consumer's asking for, if it's just an A pose, then and you really want to knock it out of that A pose, I guess.
Yeah. And you're looking at it's $1,200 and some change, I think, once it's all said and done.
You can buy a watch for that.
Yeah. You can buy at least a pair of boots, maybe a set of slippers,
and the hat.
Maybe a set of slippers.
So it is interesting, because I put my review out today. I think there are two other reviews that are out there, both by credible reviewers, people that I respect, Paik and TM reviews. I'll drop them both, but and I haven't watched their reviews yet. I plan on watching their final thoughts of both of those gentlemen, but I just, as of this recording, I have not. So I don't know what they had to say about it, but I have not heard, just in the ether alone from reviews, because they're obviously not the only two motherfuckers on the planet that have this shit. Just in the ether, I haven't heard people talking about, like, hey man, like, once you, is everybody having the same thing where once you go past this point of no return, there's no saving it? And it's just like, if it had been another company, these motherfuckers would have wrung its neck, you know?
Okay.
But anyway, I mean, overall, I think it's a good product, and I think people are happy with it, and I totally understand why. I'm just saying, for the sake of all of us being honest with ourselves and with one another, it's okay to be like, hey, I love this thing, but it doesn't do what we thought it was going to do. All right. And I think that's all I really have. I don't know if I've done anything else. I've been working a lot recently. Just nothing regular. Just haven't had any days off, and that feels like a lot recently. My sleep's been fucked and everything else. I'm trying to think if there's anything else that's been going on. Went to that little party, and just this fucking combiner has been dominating my life. You know, and it was another thing, because it's a time sensitive thing. Came at a fucking terrible time. It came in, I had to work the next day, so I got the review of the figure in, then I had to work the next day, so couldn't edit, do it then. Couldn't even start Fucked. So that day's gone. Saturday I started on it, but then we had Nick's birthday party in the afternoon, so that's, you know. And then Sunday, something was going on Sunday too.
Work?
Was it work? Yeah, Sunday I worked again. And then, and Friday I had Nerd Rage. It's like from previous. So, like, I had all this shit going on. Then Sunday I worked. And then Monday I got to finish it, put it up Tuesday, you know, but I think I'm almost a week behind. Well, it came out Thursday. So Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday is how long it took me to get it up.
Just what a busy guy you are.
Just came at the, you know.
It's mm-hmm. almost like you're on like a schedule where you work during the day.
Yeah, I am.
A day work
schedule. I am a day work schedule of sorts. Yeah. Of sorts. Just for the peripheral stuff.
Sleep, though. I mean.
Yeah, I bet. I bet it does sound nice. It does sound nice. But I still got some fight in me, buddy.
I know you do.
So let's, we have a little bit of notes, not much, but maybe some of it will spawn some conversation. So Phil Donahue died.
Oh.
Why does that name sound familiar?
He has like a talk show host like Jerry.
Phil Donahue, white hair.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah. It is interesting to me that that era is kind of over.
Yes.
The Ricky Lake, Sally Jesse, Jimmy Jones,
Jerry Springer.
Oh my goodness.
Oprah.
Geraldo. Oh, yeah, Oprah.
Yeah.
You know, like that.
Montel Jordan. I could go on.
Yeah. There was a bunch.
Yeah.
You know, and they were all
Montel Williams. Montel Jordan.
Montel Jordan. Very different.
This is how we do it.
This is how we do it.
Oh man, I'm so glad that like that just organically. This is how we do
it. There's another Montel Jordan song that I really like.
He got another one?
I know. People don't know it. I'm going to play a bit of it. It was back when Master P was like at the height of his popularity, and I think it's called "Let's Ride." The beat was just sick. Let me see here real quick.
It's funny. If somebody said, at gunpoint, name three Montel Jordan
songs. So three, I'd be in trouble.
That's what I'm saying. I'm like,
three, I'd be in trouble. But two.
I almost said five.
And it's, like, and it's called Let's Ride. Two I can get. Here we go. There he is. The beat is just... Very late 90s, early 2000s.
Doesn't even sound like a No Limit beat.
No, it's not. And the drums are very hoppy. Like.
Oh, yeah.
It sounds almost like that 112 song.
Yeah. You know Montel is body.
I'm going to listen to that on the way home.
It's good. It's a good record.
The intro sounded like that 112 song. That's why I was like,
yeah. You know Montel is body. And I think Silk the Shocker is on that song as well. Do you know that
Silk, not a whole lot of rapping getting done.
Silk the Shocker is considered the worst rapper of all time.
Yes. He might as well just be a slam poet at this point.
That motherfucker wasn't on beat for shit.
He ran from it.
He really did. And he told you it wasn't his fault.
Ain't my fault.
It is weird to me just thinking about it. Like, I think that it's really just trashy, gossipy, tea spilling television, isn't it?
Yes.
So we just replaced it with like Keeping Up with the Kardashians, Dancing with Dance Moms,
sure,
you know, shit like that. It's like just the new trashy.
It's so weird though, gossipy. Because I know we grew up on that shit, right?
Yeah,
but you couldn't tell me that shit wasn't real.
It was like, and it was lit.
It was scripted.
Yeah. Like, why they got fucking? Sure. They got the Ku Klux Klan in this motherfucker. Like,
exactly. Yeah. It was like. Who does Jerry Springer have to get these people on stage?
Yeah. Because I feel like Jerry Springer leaned into it more than those other. Yes. You know,
the others
like,
tried to be credible sometimes. Then
Jerry Springer was like, nah, I
it's like, this is a circus and I'm the ringleader.
Hold my beer. You
know? Yeah. It was just like, you know, like I remember like seeing like that was my first time seeing Ku Klux Klan, I think, in any media.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like I hadn't
seen him in person.
Not that I know of.
It's true.
I have driven through Thurmont, so I don't
we've talked about Thurmont.
Well, I told you when I worked for the state, Thurmont had trifold pamphlets
mm-hmm.
in their community center.
Oh God.
That were Klan oriented.
Oh man.
I've seen those.
I flipped out. I was like, I went, because we used to go out there for outreach. And like basically like there was two parts of Frederick County. It was Thurmont and I want to say Brunswick, where they are so isolated
uh-huh.
that we would go twice a month, one to each,
okay,
and set up shop there and interview people for food stamps and shit there, right? So like when I walked into this place, I was like, what the fuck? And I like pulled it out. I was like, the Klan has. Who in the Klan is going to Kinko's? It's KKKK.
Imagine
Kinko's Ku Klux Klan.
Oh man,
Kinko's.
You know, like, and they're like, shh, shh. And I was like, no, are we not going to acknowledge this? I was like,
they if they're handing out flyers, they want people to talk about it.
Yeah. There's somebody else I know that said that, like, lived in Thurmont, that said that they would throw, like, information in bags of sand, and they would, like, throw it to your door. So the sand would weight it to give it weight so they could, like, throw it from their car, and then it would, like, land on
your... It was like the daily paper.
Yeah. They would, like, land on your front doorstep to, like, tell you, like, where we could meet if you want to, like, get with the program. Do you know what I mean?
Good.
Speaking of dragons.
Sure. Yeah, exactly. Right? It's a grand one. I feel like there's better recruiting techniques, too, because that maybe that's kind of old school, but...
Well, it's kind of an old school organization, to be fair. Yeah,
this is true. This is true. But you got to modernize. You like if
yeah, give it the time. What's your Facebook?
What
Instagram?
Are you giving me for my time to come to your meeting?
Yeah,
like do something. Put
some
dollar
candy
in the
bottom of that bag instead of like sand.
If I'm on the fence, you giving that little bit is going to be, you know what? Maybe they aren't. So maybe there are too many.
What am I going to do with this sand?
Yeah, what am I doing with sand? I like, you're making a mess for me.
Yeah,
you know,
gets everywhere.
Yeah.
So just for your story, I looked up. Phil Donahue was 88 when he died. Mm-hmm. That motherfucker looked 68 in 95. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
so true. That is wild to me because he had—I only remember him from the white hair.
Yeah, the white hair.
I'm like, wow, 88.
Yeah,
you couldn't tell me he wasn't like over 100.
You know, my—I think I've told this on here before. I probably have. I'm starting to develop a complex about telling the same story more than once, but
that's going to eat you up.
Dude. Yeah, it's eating me up. But if God came down from heaven and said I could know one thing. Right, like the classic question, you know, people are like the meaning of life, and you know, what is love, and baby don't hurt me, and all that kind of stuff. My answer is I want to know how many Ku Klux Klan members secretly have Thriller in their basement. I want a number.
All of them.
80 million records sold.
Yeah.
Some of those motherfuckers are in some dark corners of those basements. Oh, yeah.
You talk about being able to separate the artist from, you know, the art. I feel like that's a big part. I feel like that plays a role.
And Michael made it easy for him later down
exactly.
the road.
He, you know? He did. He appealed to everybody. That motherfucker knew marketing.
That's pretty good. That's pretty good.
That's like what I said earlier. When you have a built-in fan base, he already had a built-in fan base. All right, let me go for the other fan base. You know,
just yeah, why not?
Lighten this up a little bit.
I feel like that you were going to give me some pushback on the trashy television that I was comparing it to reality TV.
So yes, and it's just a nuanced pushback. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I wonder, because we're in the streaming age versus like sitting, I have the memory of, you know, skipping school, you know, trying to get through the soap operas, and then those are sprinkled in.
Yeah.
I wonder what takes the place of like network where they sat in network TV, if it is actually
gone
or what is what is the force that's in that place of
like
daytime
that 3 p.m.
TV.
Slot.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
So like while I think
appointment television is what they call it now.
While I think philosophically, like big picture, yes.
Ridiculousness.
I don't think you're wrong about that filled that gap of that trashiness. But the, you know, the you know, autistic person in me is what actually filled that 3 p.m. slot from Monday to Friday.
I wonder. I wonder.
So that's my
a good, that's a good, that's a good point. That's a good point.
We've gotten away from network TV so much.
That's right.
Well, soap operas are still on air, which is crazy to me. Mm-hmm. But to your point, court TV is a big one.
Oh, yeah.
And court TV is an evolution of the same thing.
Yes.
It agreed. It is just two people arguing, and you know, in some cases they're actually a court of law. In some cases, it's just a set.
It's a lot of character work.
Yes.
A lot of character work. Same as with the talk shows. It was character work, and it was giving you the veil of legitimacy.
Yeah.
And this is, you know, we're really here to talk about your problems and come to a resolution. No, it's you know, it's a show.
Yeah.
Was there anybody in your home that watched soap operas growing up?
My aunt. When we went to her house, she watched soap operas.
I believe it's Auntie.
My aunt. Auntie. Auntie. Fair.
Yeah. What did she watch?
I want to say, I want to say like the regular one, Love and Restless. What's the other one? The Sands of Time. Sands of Time.
Oh,
Days of Our Lives.
Days of Our Lives. Yeah.
The big ones. And it's funny because it was one that was wild that caught my attention.
Uh-huh.
And I know she didn't fuck with it, but it came on like after or before one of her regular ones. And it's called Passions. And
I like the sound of it.
It's 13. Not what you think it is. Oh. there was, I don't know, because it caught my attention because it was like so weird. It leaned into like supernatural shit. There was a witch. There was a midget. There was like a lot. There was a lot of weird shit going on in there, and that's why it was like a soap opera, but they had all this wild shit like. For soap opera, like they had magical portals and stuff. Like, how was this a soap opera? Like, yeah. But yeah, it was the weirdest show. But I remember watching that. But yeah, I don't think my mom watched anything. But it was more my aunt.
Too. What about you, Junior?
Oh, my mom totally anything that was on during the day.
Really?
She just that TV was on and she was watching whatever. You know, no cable or anything. It was just network TV
television. Program. Yeah.
And Days of Our Lives, General Hospital.
So my grandma got down with some General Hospital. Heavy.
There was some other one. And there was a time when, I don't know, I think it was like right after high school, like, you know, just, you know, doing some college, but having a lot of time off and like watching.
Partly stoned.
Yeah, partly stoned, watching those with her and just being like, okay. Like I couldn't name you off.
Not Greta.
Character. But I don't know. Like it's you know, it's I'm gonna take some heat for this. It's a different version of wrestling. You know, it's still a soap opera. These are characters.
It goes on forever.
Yeah, it goes on forever. There's relationships and feuds and like, you know, it's just.
It is impressive that it goes for so long.
Different production. And it's impressive that some of these actors, like that is their gig for like
30 life.
Years.
Yeah.
And it's just
like retire from.
Just looking up all the 90s talk shows. Since we're sitting here talking about it, I'm just looking at them. And it's just so funny to like. Sally, Jenny, yep. Oprah, Jerry Springer, Montel, Maury, Arsenio Hall, Rosie O'Donnell. there's so many.
Ricky Lake
is on here. Is this Jenny Jones?
Ricky Lake looks like she got wild in bed to me when I was a kid.
Maybe that's why I like this
girl's women. A freak. I can tell.
She's something else.
My grandma also watched this like British soap opera. It only came on Sundays, only once a week, but it was called EastEnders. Uh-huh. And she watched it
I've heard about that.
She actually, you know, I was the center of my grandmother's life, but I used to usually go over there on Sundays for breakfast. And if I got a late start, if I had a wild Saturday or something, I got a late start, I'd end up over there at 11. And then, you know, eat breakfast, hanging out, bullshitting. And you could see her get to looking at the clock, you know, like around 1:30, 2-ish. Like, how long is this motherfucker going to stay here? she loved that shit. My mom wasn't a big soap opera person because she was working all the time, but she was a big like Dallas Falcon Crest, like that shit that used to Dynasty.
One of those, like okay, yeah,
that shit that I know came on at night. That was like a you know what I mean a soap opera on primetime.
The primetime soap opera,
exactly. My next note is this: there's another movie coming out from Kevin Smith.
Oh,
called 4:30. I think it's called the 4:30 movie. So I watched the trailer for it. I found it to be relatively unremarkable. But it's a young boy has a crush on a young girl, invites her to a movie. They're supposed to go see this movie at 4:30 is when the showing is. And then I think when they go there, they end up getting kicked out of the movie theater before the movie. And then the drama kind of ensues. It does look like a decent slice of life of like, retro going steady with a girl, having your parents drop you off, like
which is
charming to me in some ways to see something like that, like before the cell phones, it seems, before
kind of a period piece.
Yeah, it has that feel. I don't know if I'm right about it, but it has that feel. So it doesn't look bad, but it doesn't look like, oh, I'm gonna run out to see this shit. It just looks like one thing that was funny about it, they're like Kevin Smith, the creator of, and then it had like this, and it was like, you know, all the big ones like, you know, Clerks and Mallrats and, you know, Tusk. Dogma and, you know, not that one, you know, but a lot of them. And then it said down at the bottom and probably Clerks 4. but that was the funniest part of that trailer to me.
Really?
It was that moment. And it doesn't look bad. It just doesn't look like something I'm excited to see.
You think he was just maybe excited to make it?
Yeah, I don't know. Like, that dude, he did say something one time in a... because he used to do these things at conventions. I don't know if he does them anymore because he's a fucking superstar now, you know? But he used to do these things at conventions where he would host, like, a... a Q&A of sorts. He would get up there, he would talk a little bit about what he had going on, and then he would just let people line up and ask him questions.
Yeah.
And one of the funnier things that he ever said was this dude who was, I shouldn't say obviously, but I would say presented as a homosexual person, was like, can I go back to your hotel room with you?
Oh, shit.
Was like the question that he asked Kevin Smith. And Kevin Smith was like, dude, I'm straight, but if you have a boyfriend here, I will definitely come up and watch you two fuck. Just because. And he was like, and I'll probably just text Jay while I'm up there, like, dude, you'll never believe it. These two families fuck. It's fucking nuts. And then the other thing that he said that really struck me is he was like, the reason why Clerks is successful is because I was a fucking clerk. And he was like, you just write what you know. That's the key to success with that shit. And it did get me thinking, like, you know, like I was a creative person and I've written a bunch of stuff and tried it. Like, man, I should write a movie. I should write a TV show. I should write a book. I should write but it's always these extravagant, like I'm trying to plan, build the world and this and that. I'm like, man, if I just probably wrote a book or a TV show about mopping, it'd probably be the fuck out of here.
Yeah.
You know?
Easy. Because it's relatable and it's what you know. And there's moppers all over the country. That's exactly how that is, as opposed to people in a room who have never mopped a day in their life.
Right.
Trying to come up with what they think it is and calling their buddy Jeff who mopped on a, kind of a volunteer basis almost and just like, hey, I just like mopping at home.
Yeah. Even doing a movie about like a fucking low budget, like content creator movie, reviews, ends up at a convention or whatever. You know, it's like it is the key to that shit. And I think that as Kevin, obviously you can't just do Clerks forever, but I think like Mallrats was adjacent to it, Jay and Silent Bob obviously is adjacent to it. Like a lot of the stuff that really works is adjacent to it. But I think when he did Dogma, which is still adjacent to it in its own way, but it's much more grand, it's more broad, it's more ideas, it's more complex, and it was successful.
Yeah.
That's what got him just doing any old fucking thing.
Yeah.
And I think at least this is probably a true to life version of him in his early teens, starting to meet girls and do all that shit, which I thought was cool. All right, and then the last note that maybe could spawn some discussion is RIP to the Acolyte.
Yeah.
Seemingly.
Yeah.
So I've seen I went where I want balance. Whenever I want like a balanced, truthful, honest opinion about something, I always go to the same source.
Okay.
Twitter, right?
Yeah.
And I just read the filth on there until I found myself getting upset, and then I closed the app. Mm-hmm. But basically, I saw three points of view, and I subscribed to the third. Spoilers. There was people on there saying, wow, just because they do a show about women and women of color and Asian men and this and that, you guys have finally shown your true colors and you got this show canceled. You bitched on the internet and you got the show canceled. That was one.
Mm-hmm.
The second one was, this show is canceled because it just fucking sucks. And it fucking sucks, so it's fucking canceled. Fuck Disney, fuck Star Wars, fuck Lucasfilm, fuck them all. It fucking sucks. Fuck the Acolyte. Rest in peace. Mm-hmm. And then the third one, which is the one that I subscribe to, was it's simply numbers and algorithms. They looked at the success of the show. They looked at how much streams it was getting. They looked at how long people were watching it. They looked at how long it stayed in the top 10. It didn't perform, and they canceled it.
That's more things than not these days.
Like, my buddy Irish Andy, he tracked the numbers on that show, the streaming number. Well, they don't really publish streaming numbers, but where it sits in the echelon. And he predicted it. He was like, look, I don't see a season two out of this. Hmm. He's like, it's nowhere is it premiering at number one, and it's not staying in the top 10 inside of a week.
Right.
You know?
Yeah. That's a,
And the shows were expensive. Mm-hmm. It was an expensive ass show because they didn't do whatever it was, that shit with the background, the volume. Yeah. They didn't do the volume. They did real sets. They did, they traveled and all that shit. And it just, I think it didn't capture enough people's attention. So not a lot of people bought in initially. Mm-hmm. Then the word of mouth about it spread. It spread negatively. Mm-hmm. So the people that didn't jump in on day one didn't bother jumping in.
Got no reason mm-hmm. to.
And then the show concluded. People felt however they felt about it. And I think it just didn't perform. So they got it the fuck out of here.
It is what it is. I mean, it, like you said, I think it's an algorithm thing more often than not. There's, you know, I've never watched it, never cared to. So it's mm-hmm. not a big deal for me. I couldn't care less. One more, one less thing for me to watch. Oh,
I don't buy into, and generally speaking, the things fail simply because of diversity. I was watching some old shows recently, and I was like, man, I was like, a lot of the shit that I grew up with was diverse as fuck mm-hmm. and never felt like it had to be.
Right.
You know, like I was looking at like old G.I. Joe clips, partially because I was trying to find goofy ones to make fun of it. But still, I was just amazed. I was like, look at, I was like, you know, some of them are stereotypical, right? Like, I don't know if there's any Native American character ever created that doesn't have tassels on their boots. Okay. I don't know if that ever.
Or a feather somewhere.
Or a feather somewhere.
Yeah.
And this one even had a fucking pet hawk that, like,
see, ran on it. Lean into it.
You know, and his name was Spirit. You know, like it's always yeah. always Spirit or Thunderhawk or
running,
some shit.
Running Wind.
Yeah. You know, and Quick Kick, obviously, like, went to, you know, he was a martial artist and wore just Asian. Karate pants, and he was Asian, and he went to war in that outfit. But, I mean, there was Asian characters, there was Native American characters, there were Hispanic characters, there were black characters, there were female characters, there were male characters, like, there was white characters, there was, like, the only thing that wasn't really there were gay characters, you know?
That and, we knew of.
Well, and I was going to say, and even some of them, you're like, I got my eye on you, you know? Like, you know, or at least characters that were a little like more gender fluid. Like Wheelie from Transformers is a more gender fluid character. Like it wasn't, I didn't know if Wheelie was a boy or a girl until later on when I clearly understood that Grimlock said, "Why boy hit my nose?" Mm-hmm. And I was like, that's the only reason why I knew that was a girl. So there is some stuff in there, but just generally speaking, I mean, there was just like, there was a lot of it, and it never felt like it was going out of, it felt like the real world.
Yeah.
Where like you just go into the grocery store and there's just fucking different types of people because different fucking types of people live here, you know? And I don't really buy into that argument about that people do with that shit. You know, I don't think that you replace the Acolyte, mm-hmm. that story, you replace every single character with a white man. That show still fucking sucks.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. I think it's a case of, for those content creators, producers, I think it's kind of like that Jeep effect. Like, oh, I want a Jeep. And then after that, all you're seeing is Jeeps.
Uh-huh.
And now you're focused on it. So for them, what the rest of us kind of hadn't seen, you know, you describe it. I mean, heck, even this Alien movie, diverse casts across the board.
Yeah.
I think in the contrary to Acolyte, it would have done just as well if you didn't have a diverse cast.
Right.
But they had it, and it didn't get in front of a good story. It didn't get in front of mm-hmm. good production. They got it in, and great, cool, didn't detract. Lead, you know, we have the same argument about a strong female lead.
Mm-hmm.
Aliens like, kind of established that
yeah,
of a strong female
Star Wars
lead.
Too.
Doesn't it doesn't
Leia and Ripley are two of the strongest female characters ever.
Right. And as a male, I don't have any qualms about Ripley or in this one Rain. Mm-hmm. Like I'm along for the story.
Sarah Connor.
Because it mm-hmm. makes sense to you me. Know?
Yeah.
I think there are instances where these producers see something locked in their head and then it's everywhere and they want to shoehorn it in regardless of the content. I think that there is, you know, X-Men, for example, is making some commentary about 100%. Racism in the 70s, 80s.
Mm-hmm. And I think gays in the 80s, 90s. And, yes. And you can make the argument for trans in the 2010s.
Mm. And in that, no problem for putting or for slipping that current ostracized group into
it
that.
Always fits.
It always fits.
It always fits.
So I think a lot of the problems is we, and that's contrary to you know, the recent Alien movie, fanboy versus non-fanboy.
Mm-hmm.
And I think what you have with a lot of the Star Wars is people that aren't fans, or Marvel, you have some of these writers who don't read the comic books at all, and wear that as a, you know,
a flag of honor.
A flag of honor. In reality, like, understanding this content, because there are people that, you know, love it and identify with it.
Yep.
Bringing people in that don't respect that, and that, you know, kind of swinging a meat cleaver around in the production of this, I think that's where it goes wrong. I mean, the Alien stuff, I consider myself in my core as primarily an Alien fan. Bobby, maybe I have a, you know, incorrect take on you. I look at you and you are a DC Batman. Not to say that I can't come in and have some commentary about Batman.
Yeah.
But you have an understanding with it and a emotional attachment and a evolution of who you are in that character throughout 100%. Time. So someone that comes in and doesn't understand that and just...
It's instantly recognizable.
Yes. And starts swinging around and putting stuff in there that doesn't apply. It is incongruent to that story. That's the period that we're in a lot with Marvel and DC, of someone else trying to shove something in there. Again, I think X-Men fleshing it out, yes, trans, gay, you know, racism, like, it all fits in there.
Perfectly.
You know, just like in Aliens. You know, it's a class, there's a class struggle 100%. Argument.
There's and a so, corporation,
you know, there's capitalism, socialism.
Yep.
All those things are entirely appropriate to sprinkle on in this cosmic horror realm, putting in other ideas that, you know, at least having the care to go, okay, is this a proper stage to present this? And I think that's the problem. We're getting a lot of writers who are just like, you know what, my stories didn't get us to this point, but let me change stuff around.
Yeah. And I think that sometimes, like, it has to make, like, sometimes, like, in the real world stuff specifically, is like, like, I spent a lot of time in the Fordham area of the Bronx in the early 2000s.
Mm-hmm.
And if you've ever been in that area, it is a capital P, capital R Puerto Rican area.
Mm-hmm.
If you were to do a movie that took place on those streets, I want to run to see it because I've spent some time there. I'm familiar with those streets. I know the vibe and I'm interested in it. But if I go there and it's an all white cast or an all black cast or an all Asian cast, I'm going to be like, this, you missed it.
Mm-hmm.
This isn't how these streets feel, you know?
Yeah.
It's like, sometimes it's, and then sometimes it doesn't, like, you take the Acolyte. So I've been vocal here about the lack of character design of Star Wars villains recently. Like, they just are so dull and boring. There's Ahsoka had this old white guy and this young white lady, and I've been calling them Darth Steve and Darth Joanne, right?
Yeah.
And then now in Acolyte, you have a black female, so I've been calling her Darth Rita, and now the three of them form the trifecta of the Darth Norms, right? Oh. They're just Darth Normies.
Yeah.
You know? And it's like, they just look like regular characters in that world, whereas, like, if you look at, like, Vader or Maul or, you know, it's like, oh, wait, that one's up, that guy's not, he's up no good, easily. I know it. Right. I can tell from here.
Right.
You know? And it has lost something there, and I think that it becomes more obvious when you start looking at this material that they're producing now, that these people that are making these shows, they just don't understand the material.
Yeah.
They don't understand the world that they're in. And I have a hard time with that because I know people like Pablo Hidalgo are there. I know people like Filoni is there. These people that I do know understand this world, but I just don't understand where the lack of communication or mixed match is happening to create this very subpar average ass shit. I don't know if you've seen the fucking trailer for this other, the Skeleton Crew show.
No.
It's like a Goonies in Star Wars is like how I would describe it. Yeah. Like if Rogue One was Saving Private Ryan in Star Wars, this is like Goonies in Star Wars, which I think is actually a cool concept.
Yeah.
But watching it, I'm like, man, I already feel like you guys have missed it.
Yeah.
I feel like it's the perfect world to do something like that in. Yeah. And I feel like you've already missed it. I would love for them. There was like a YouTube short of like Stormtroopers that was like, it was kind of like Cops, but they were Stormtroopers.
Yeah.
And they were like going around. They end up going to like a domestic for Beru and Owen, you know, and then the whole thing, the fight that happens there, how Beru and Owen die and all that is all because they call the police for a domestic situation. Oh. That, like, you know, like, it's funny as shit, but like, I think if you did more. What I'm saying is it doesn't have to be serious for me. It doesn't have to be like this, dark and gritty. It doesn't. Star Wars has the DNA where you can play with anything that you want.
It's big enough.
As long as it's true to it.
Yeah.
You know? You can do a comedy with these stormtroopers that are kind of goofs as cops showing up on that are like, your normal patrol. You know, they haven't made detective. They probably never will. You know what I mean? They're grunts and they're fucking... You know, they didn't graduate at the top of their class.
Funny, because that's something, I'm not even a Star Wars guy, but that's something I would watch. Yeah. I would at least check out a couple episodes. But
as long as it was funny, but it was like, it was funny in the sense where we're laughing with it and we're never laughing collectively. The creators or us are laughing at it.
Yes.
You know, that's important.
Yeah.
Let me see if I got any questions. We have one little email I know to read, but if you want to send a question.
You can email us at nerdrageradiomail@gmail.com.
Well, and speaking of that voice that you just heard, that was done by Brandy. She's sent in a number of things for us, and she's had some health issues that we've been kind of covering. So we got an update. I was just going to read it. Said last time with some shit going on, I wrote that Brandy and our son were in a horrific accident, and the nerd table stepped up and helped us out. Thank you three and all the listeners for that. Due to the accident, Brandy's body said, fuck this, and she has some stuff flare up that we didn't know was there. We found out that she has tethered cord syndrome, which is finally scheduled for surgery in September. Basically, the doc is going to make an incision and cut her spinal cord away from whatever is attached to. We're hoping that she will heal and that it will help with the constant pain. Here's hoping. Brandy loves the show. We listen every week together. We both truly appreciate you three. And makes a difference to your fan base. I wish I could make more of the Zoom calls, but life happens. Keep doing the good work. We love y'all. Peace and love from Oregon, which he spelled out phonetically for me as Oregon. I say Oregon, it sounds like Lord of the Rings, you know?
Like Lord Oregon.
Lord Oregon, the traveler. Just to help Bobby pronounce it. So thanks for the update. I hope everything goes well with her surgery and best thoughts and well wishes.
Yeah.
And
recovery.
Yeah, for sure. And let me just double check that we didn't get an email because we've been sitting here for a couple hours. I'll turn off my Wi-Fi just in case that has any impact. Let's see if I got any hate mail too. I could for that fucking review. But yeah, looks like we're good. So we'll get out of here. Chucky O, Evan, thanks for coming by. You actually helped me a lot because I was in a pinch, obviously. And hopefully, you know, I appreciate everybody that kind of steps up and fills the voids, so to speak.
Yeah.
Because it does help me out a lot. And shout out to Joe and Chris both on assignment. Shout out and congratulations once again to Joe. Shout out to Phil on Twitter in our notes. Shout out to Dante on Facebook. And with that,
Crusty Canthus.
Tasty Kula.
Tight dick player.